Lecture 4. The theme of our lecture for today is the writers of Norman period. Objectives. After going through this lecture, you will be able to discuss the Anglo-Norman period in a detailed manner. To explain the major literary forms of the Anglo-Norman period. To explore some of the major literary works by the Norman writers. Gain an idea on the development of English literature starting from the Anglo-Saxon period. During this lecture, we are going to discuss the following questions. The first one, Geoffrey Chaucer, Life and Creative Activity. And the second one is Canterbury Tales by Geoffrey Chaucer. Normans who conquered England were originally members of the same stock as the Danes who had harried and conquered it in the preceding centuries. The ancestors of both were bands of Baltic and North Sea pirates who merely happened to immigrate in different directions. And a little further back, the Normans were close cousins in the genuine Germanic family of the Anglo-Saxons themselves. The exploits of this whole race of North Sea kings make one of the most remarkable chapters in the history of medieval Europe. Geoffrey Chaucer, the greatest writer of the 14th century, was born in London. Chaucer, the name is a French and seems to have meant originally shoemaker, came into the world probably in 1338, the first important author who was born and lived in London, which with him becomes the center of English literature. About his life as above those of many of our earlier writers, there remains only very fragmentary information, which in his case is largely pieced together from scattering entries of various kinds in such documents as court account books and public records of state matters and of lawsuits. His father, a wine merchant, may have helped supply the cellars of the King Edward III and so have been able to bring his son to a royal notice at any rate. While still in his teens, Geoffrey became a page in the service of one of the king's daughters-in-law. In this position, his duty would be partly to perform various humble work in the household, partly also to help him use the leisures of the inmates, and it's easy to suppose that he soon won favor as a fluent storyteller. He early became acquainted with the seamy as well as the brilliant side of courtly life, for in 1359 he was in the campaign in France and was taken prisoner. That he was already valued appears from the king's subscription of the equivalent of $1,000 of present-day money towards his ransom. And after his release, he was transferred to the king's own service, where about 1368 he was promoted to the rank of esquire. He was probably already married to one of the queen's ladies-in-waiting. Chaucer was now 30 years of age, and his practical sagacity and knowledge of man had been recognized, for from this time on he held important public positions. He was often sent to the continent, to France, Flanders, and Italy on diplomatic missions, and for 11 years he was in charge of the London customs, where the uncongenial drudgery occupied almost all his time until, through the intercession of the Queen, he was allowed to perform it by deputy. In 1386, he was a Member of Parliament, Knight of the Shire for Kent, but in that year his fortune turned. He lost all his officers of the overthrow of the faction of his patron, Duke John of Gaunt, uncle of the young king. Chaucer, partly and himself, were soon restored to power, but although during the remaining dozen years of his life he received from the court various temporary appointments and rewards, he appears often to have been poor and in need. When Duke Henry of Bolingbroke, son of John of God, deposed the king and himself amused the throne as Henry IV, Choice's prosperity seemed assured, but he lived after his for less than a year and suddenly died. At the age of 17, Geoffrey Chaucer became a page of the lady in the court of King Edward III. At the age of 20, he was in France taking part in war actions as a squire. There he was captured by the French. His friends helped him. They asked the king to ransom him, and he did it. He was buried in Westminster Abbey, the first of the men of letters to be laid in the nook which has since become the Poet's Corner. Chaucer's poetry falls into three rather clearly marked periods. First is that of French influence, when though writing in English, he drew inspiration from the rich French poetry of the period, which was produced partly in France, partly in England. Chaucer experimented with the numerous lyric forms which the French poets had brought to perfection. He also translated in whole or in part the most important of medieval French narrative poems, the 13th century Romance of the Rose, a very clever satirical allegory in many thousand lines of medieval love and medieval religion. This poem, with its Gaelic brilliancy and audacity, long exercised over Chaucer's mind the same dominant influence which it possessed over more secular poets of the age. Chaucer's second period, that of Italian influence, dates from his first visit to Italy in 1372 and 1373, where at Padua he may perhaps have met the fluent Italian poet Petrarch, and where at any rate the revelation of Italian life and literature must have aroused the intense enthusiasm. From this time, and especially after his other visit to Italy 5 years later, he made much direct use of the works of Petrarch and Boccaccio, and to a less degree of those of their greater predecessor Dante, whose severe spirit was too unlike Chaucer's for his thorough inspiration. The longest and finest of Chaucer's poems of this period, Troilus and Crusade, is based on a work of Boccaccio. Here Chaucer details with compelling power and sentiment and tragedy of love and the psychology of the heroine who had become for the Middle Ages a central figure in the tale of Troy. Chaucer's third period, conveying his last 50 years, is called his English period because now at last his genius mater and self-sufficient worked in essential independence. First in time among his poems of these years stands The Legend of Good Women, a series of romantic biographies of famous ladies of classical legend and history. In the 17th, he traveled a lot and lived a busy life. Alongside with a diplomatic mission, he got interested in the French and Italian literature, especially poetry. At the early period of his creative activity, he translated French poems into English and then wrote his own poems alike the French. Thus, a famous allegorical poem of the 14th century was The Romance of the Rose. It was translated by him. The second period reveals the Italian influence of Dante. During this period, he wrote The House of Fame, a deductive poem presented in allegorical form which criticized English Parliament. Troilus and Crusade based on an ancient myth about love of two lovers. The third period, the most important one, begins in 1384 when he began writing his masterpiece The Canterbury Tales, in which he showed various ranks of the contemporary society and summed up the literary genres existed at that time. Historical background. The Canterbury Tales is written in Middle English, recognized as the first book of poetry written in the English language. A collection of stories that read like a storytelling competition between a small group of pilgrims and their journey to see St. Thomas Becket's shrine at the Canterbury Cathedral. This book presents a series of stories written in verse. It begins with a general prologue in which he introduces the characters of these stories. The framework which serves to connect the stories is the pilgrimage of the Canterbury. Canterbury is the most important cathedral with the shrine of Thomas Becket, a bishop in the 12th century who struggled against the king Henry VII. After his death, Thomas Becket became a saint by the church. The pilgrims traveled every spring to that shrine because they believed that Thomas Becket had a miraculous power to cure diseases. 29 pilgrims took part in the pilgrimage, and when the author described the aim of their meeting, he got acquainted with the pilgrim, that thus he draws a rapid portrait of pilgrims in which he showed the most striking character. The pilgrimage is a democratic institution which means that rich and poor, noble and peasants, rode side by side, united by the same aim. The characters of the book include a knight, a monk, a student, miller, and a lawyer. The most pleasant for the author was the knight who opened the list of pilgrims. The knight possessed bravery and modesty. On the other hand, he presented the portrait of a miller who represented a new class bourgeoisie. Every of these characters had to tell a story on the way to Canterbury. By means of different stories, Chaucer represented all the literary genres at that time. As for the genres, he shows a romance, a moral story, a fable, a fable. The Canterbury Tales were not finished. Summary. The narrator describes the pilgrims, revealing their personalities through direct and indirect characterization, sharp images, and figurative comparisons. Chaucer's description of dress and appearance are particularly revealing of psychological traits. The pilgrims generally fall into three major divisions of medieval society: the feudal order, the knight and his squire, the church, the monk and the nun, the merchant or professional class, the miller and the doctor. The great work of the period, however, and the crowning achievement of Chaucer's life is the Canterbury Tales. Everyone is familiar with the plan of the story, how Chaucer finds himself on one April evening with 30 other men and women all gathered at the Tabard Inn in Southwark, a suburb of London and just across the Thames from the city proper, ready to start next morning as thousands of English did every year. This literary form, a collection of disconnected stories bound together in a fictional framework, goes back almost to the beginning of literature itself. But Chaucer may well have been directly influenced by Boccaccio's famous book of prose tales, the Decameron. Between the two works, however, there is a striking contrast which has often been pointed out. While the Italian also represents the gentlemen and ladies as selfishly fleeing from the misery of frightful plague in Florence to a charming villa and a holiday of unreflecting pleasure, the gaiety of Chaucer's pilgrims rests on a basis of serious purpose, however conventional it may be. To speak of the merits of this work, we may say that it was a great Chaucer's contribution to the English and world literature. In the whole world, there are only 12 copies of this book. He shows the size of the end of feudalism and the features of new bourgeoisie society. Chaucer was a creator of a new literary language, showed the peculiarity of the language in this work. His poetry is rich, lively, and expressive. He created new words which remain to the present time. Chaucer was the earliest English poet, the founder of the English language and literature, which is valued today. This is the end of our lecture. Here in this very slide, you can see the questions for self-checking. The first one is, in which century were Geoffrey Chaucer's Canterbury Tales written? The next, the most well-known work written by Geoffrey Chaucer is. Canterbury Tales consist of. When does the Canterbury Tales take place? For which social classes did Chaucer write? How did Geoffrey Chaucer contribute to the Renaissance? And the last one, what is Chaucer's purpose in writing the Canterbury Tales? In this slide, you can see the glossary and the terms concerning the lecture. Here given the literature for further reading.